last 2 weeks we've been looking at the book of Romans. We have seen Romans 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We have seen Romans 9, 10, and 11. We looked at the law, why many people are becoming the sons of the law and they are trying to fulfill a righteousness by obeying the law even after Christ has become their righteousness. And I titled the message, The Sons of the Law. A second part of the message that I want to really start today is called The Sons of Lawlessness, which we're going to look at in Romans and chapter 6. If you turn your Bibles with me to Romans and chapter 6, and we're going to introduce get into this topic, Romans and chapter 6. Romans chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. 1 and 2, we saw why people without the law of God are under condemnation. Then we saw in Romans chapter 3 and 4 and 5 that people under the law are also in sin. They're all condemned in sin. That's Romans 4, 5, 3, 4, and 5. But once we come to Romans 6, here in Romans 6, the Bible is talking about so many Christians, after coming to Jesus, are still walking in disobedience to the word of God. So Romans 1 and 2, the people without the law are struggling under sin. Romans 3, 4, and 5, the people under the Mosaic law, the Jewish people, are struggling under sin. Romans chapter 6, Paul at 6 and 7, Paul is introducing why so many believers after coming to God, they are now struggling under sin. So many Christians struggling under sin. Let's look at that portion. Romans chapter 6 and verse 1. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may increase? Romans chapter 5, you know, till 5, Paul was introducing a righteousness that came by the grace of God. He was saying so beautifully, till Romans 4, it was under the law, Abraham and everybody else. You know, Abraham connected to God by faith. In chapter 5, he says, a righteousness which is a gift of righteousness which comes by faith. Romans 6, 1 says, wait a minute. He said, I'm hearing there are people that are saying, now that we have come to God, now that we've become the righteousness of God, we can live however we want. And this is what I want to address over this week and probably over the next week, where many, many people are saying, now that I'm the righteousness of God, oh, I can live how I want. It's so exciting. God is my righteousness. He's forgiven me my sin. Everything is past. All my past is washed away. And now that God's my righteousness, Paul is saying, should we continue to sin that grace may increase? May it never be. How shall we who died to sin still live in it? Now here's the real deal. The Bible declares every Christian has died to sin. Can you say that to me? Died to sin. Say, I am dead to sin. Now how did you die to sin? You died to sin because Christ was crucified in your place. The moment he took your place, you died to sin. And the Bible says in Galatians 2:20, you were crucified with him. Amen. The moment you are crucified with Christ, the moment you are crucified with him, you have died to everything that you wanted to live in. You died to your past nature. You died to your old ways of life. You died to your personal preferences. Paul is saying, you who died to sin, are you still living in it? Wait a minute, Paul is saying, I thought you have become a slave of righteousness. That's what Romans in chapter 5, 17 says. You've got a gift of righteousness and this righteousness is ruling in you. You've become a slave of righteousness. Once you have become a slave of righteousness, why is it that we are struggling with sin? Now, this is a very legitimate question. I will answer this question after a couple of weeks. All right, especially as I continue teaching, because we're talking about the law. Today we're talking about lawlessness, and we're going to talk about the spirit of liberty. How can a Christian walk in the liberty of God? It is such a powerful thing to be liberated. It is so powerful to be able to live a full life. You just heard Zylan, even as he was sharing, he was saying, you know, in the past I wanted to walk in victory, but I could not. But now, you know, as I come to God, when I received his love, that's the difference between, you know, being under bondage and walking in freedom, receiving and experiencing this love of God. Once you experience the love of God, Paul is asking, how can you continue in sin? Is it possible? Is it possible for us to walk on in sin? And then he goes on to say, for don't you know those who are being baptized are baptized to the death of Christ? And we have now been resurrected into the newness of life. Verse 4, it says, so that we might walk in the newness of life. Everybody that's been baptized, what you have done is you have not done a ceremony. You have actually symbolically died. You're saying, I am dead. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live now, I live by faith in the Son of God. Oh, the life I live now is not my life. The life I live now is Christ's life living through me. Hallelujah. Say it after me, it is Christ. You know, it's the life of Christ that is living through me. It is the power of Christ. And he's saying, if it is the life of Christ, then how is it? How is it that you continue to walk in sin? How is it that you continue to walk in sin? So Paul goes on in the next chapter. He goes on to say, even as he says in this, in the next chapter, chapter 7, he says, wait a minute, but I got a problem. I understand what your problem is, because there are two parts of me. There is a sin nature and there is a spirit nature. And the sin nature in me, even though the things I do not want to do, I am ending up doing. I really don't want to do it. I don't want to break God's heart. I don't want to walk in disobedience. But I don't know why I end up doing what is breaking God's heart. Who will deliver me from this body of sin? Paul understands the challenge. He knows exactly what you're talking about. He knows the challenge that you and I have been through. And the Bible is, but yet before he gets into the answer, he's asking, should we continue sinning? Because we are no longer slaves of unrighteousness, but we are slaves of righteousness. Therefore, we are to walk in the newness of life. Verse 5 says, for if we have become united with him and in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him. Everyone say that with me. Crucified with him. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. So when you're crucified with him, you are declaring, I am dead, I am buried, I am resurrected with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And then he goes on to say, for in verse 8, for if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also in the likeness of his resurrection. It comes in verse 8. Now if we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, is never to die again. Death no longer is master over him. What is the Bible saying? The Bible is saying Christ is raised from the dead. He cannot die anymore. In the same way you are raised from the dead, you cannot die and go back to your sinful nature anymore. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If the resurrection power of God is great, is really alive and active in the life of Jesus, in the same way we who are the sons of God, that same resurrection power is alive and active in our lives. We don't have to go back to sin. And then it says in verse 10, for the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives unto God. Even so, consider yourself to be dead to sin. Consider yourself to be dead to sin. God is saying, I want you to be dead to sin. Now, I have noticed around the world, especially many, many churches, people are afraid to talk about these things anymore. They want to talk about you just be happy. God loves you. You are kind of nice. You know, everything's okay. And they do not realize that many, many people are living a life of lawlessness, are living a life moved, some under the law, trying to be righteous by their legalism. Other, because they say the grace of God has come, I can live however I want, anywhere I'm on this highway to heaven. Therefore, because of that, nothing's going to happen to me. And Paul is saying, wait a minute, you are crucified with Christ. Now the life you live is Christ in you. And now that you are resurrected, it is Christ resurrected. How can you die again? And how can you live in that sin again? Therefore, verse 12 says, therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body that you should obey its lust. Now, suddenly, this whole issue of what do I do with the sin issue in my life? What do I do when I'm tempted about something? The Bible is saying you do not allow sin to rule you or reign you. And I'm going to talk about how we do that And the answer in the New Testament way is not by condemning ourselves. The answer is not by going back to the law. The answer is not by saying, I'm going to try again, I'm going to try again, by your own strength. You cannot. The answer is by a life in the Holy Spirit. This life in the Holy Spirit is the key of deliverance for you to walk away from lawlessness. Hallelujah. This life in the Spirit is the key breakthrough. I'll deal with it in more detail in the coming days. But because I want to deal with this lawlessness aspect. But the Bible says in verse 13, do not go on presenting the members of your body as instruments of righteousness, unrighteousness, but present yourself to God as those alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Now, some people say, I don't need to do anything. I just need to stand like that because I am the grace of God. I just stand like that and suddenly I become all righteous. No, the Bible is saying you have to not present your body as instruments of righteousness, which means there is my part and there is God's part. What is God's part? He died on the cross. He paid the penalty of sin. Now there is no more penalty for my past. How many of you are happy there is no more penalty for your past? Amen. Not only is there no more penalty for the past, there is also power for the present. Hallelujah. How many of you are happy there is power for the present? That power is through the Holy Spirit. It is not by talking to yourself and hurting yourself because of sinning, but by saying, he has not only canceled the penalty of my past, he's also giving me power for the present. And that power for the present comes from the Holy Ghost. And how does he say that? He says, now that you have the Holy Ghost in you, do not any longer continue to offer. You don't make an offer of your body as an instrument of unrighteousness. Don't give your tongue to slander. Don't give your mind to think. Now, what? Because whatever we offer ourselves to, we think we are taking a decision, but the Bible says, whatever we offer ourselves to, we become that one's slave. The fact is, you are not sinning, you are becoming a slave to sin because of offering yourself. What happens when we offer our lives? This offering ourselves, whatever we offer ourselves to, if it's a particular thinking pattern, if it's a particular emotional deal, whatever you offer yourself to, that begins to rule you. And that becomes a philosophy, that becomes a life, that becomes a way of life. Verse 13, it says, do not offer yourself for unrighteousness, but to righteousness. And then it says, for sin shall not be master over you. Hallelujah. Amen. Say it after me. Sin shall not master me. For I am not under the law, but I am under the grace of God. You know what the Bible is saying? Once the grace of God has come, sin will not be your ruler. You can walk free from sin. You can walk a free life. You don't have to be whipped by sin and hurt by sin. You know, sin has consequences. A lot of people think there is no consequence of sin. Sin has consequences. One day someone was sharing, he said like this. He said, you know, you get into a fight with your friend and your friend punches your nose and breaks your nose and breaks your finger. Then after some time, next day, you feel terrible. You go back to your friends and you say, hey, sorry, macha. I didn't want to do that. Last night, we both were drunk. And, you know, I'm sorry, macha. It just didn't happen. But, you know, you can say sorry to each other. You can forgive each other. But, you know, there's a consequence. There's a broken nose. There's a broken finger. Sin has consequences. Even after you've come to Christ. There are people that I have seen that they've come to Christ. They walked with God. And then they backslide and live in sin with someone else. And when they get into an immoral relationship, a child is born outside wedlock. Sin has consequence. Now you might say, God, forgive me. God will forgive you, but there's a consequence. And that is why many, many people who are getting into this whole teaching of hyper grace, I am the righteousness of God, I can live how I want. You can live how you want. But if you have a child outside wedlock, that child is going to pay a price for the consequences of your sin. Sin has consequence. You drive too fast and you go off a cliff on a hillock where it says you should go only at 40. You go at 80 kilometers an hour and you're flying off that hillock and you're saying, oh, no problem, by the grace of God. By the grace of God, you will be dead soon. That's not by the grace of God. That's foolishness. Because you are not, you know, the Bible says, talks about how sin shall not be your master. For you are not under law, but under grace. So then he goes on to say, verse 16, do you not know that when you present yourself to someone as slaves of obedience, you are the slave of whom you obey? If you obey sin, you're that one's slave. If you obey your emotions, you're the slave of your emotions. If you obey your, you know, whatever you're obeying, if you're obeying your angry compulsions, you are a slave of your anger. You're not ruling over your anger. Your anger is ruling over you. And that anger will have consequences. That anger will destroy your life. So that's what God is saying. Now that you have received Christ and you have come to the grace of God, why are you taking that grace in vain? But then you might ask, how can I not take that grace in vain? How can I walk in victory? Oh, by the Holy Spirit. There is an intimate relationship where your righteousness comes neither from your legalistic do's and don'ts. Your righteousness does not come from your lawlessness. It comes from the finished work on the cross, and he's given you the Holy Spirit of God. Do you not know when you present your bodies slaves of obedience, you become the slave of one you obey? Verse 17, but thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart to that form of teaching to which you are committed. And having been freed from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. You know, as Paul is saying, he said, if you are freed from sin, then slave yourself to righteousness. You decide in your heart, from today onwards, I'm a slave of righteousness. I am no longer going to offer my body as instruments of unrighteousness, but I'm going to offer my body as instruments of righteousness. I'm going to be the slave of righteousness. And he says in 19, I'm speaking in human terms because of weakness of your flesh. For just as you presented your members to impurity and lawlessness, just as you presented your members to impurity and lawlessness, resulting in further lawlessness. Everybody say lawlessness, resulting in lawlessness. Can you see here? Here Paul is presenting a new thought, a thought where he's saying, just like at one time you presented your life to lawlessness, that lawlessness led you to lawlessness. Now present your body to righteousness, and this righteous life will lead you to a greater righteous life. Hallelujah. Every act of obedience, every act of righteousness, it's not by our will, it is not by our strength, but it is by the Holy Spirit. We can obey the word of God, and every step of righteousness gives us strength to walk in righteousness further. Therefore, what benefit were you then deriving from the things which you are now ashamed of? For the outcome of those things is death. But now, having been freed from sin, enslaved to God, you derive your benefit, resulting in sanctification and outcome eternal life. Freed from sin, joined to God, free from unrighteousness. Now I'm going to live a life of righteousness leading to eternal life. Sanctified. What a joy to be able to do that. What a joy. Then Paul goes on. It is in this context Paul is saying, for the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Lawlessness will lead you to further lawlessness. What really is lawlessness? When you study the Bible, lawlessness is not the absence of the law. But rather, according to the Bible, lawlessness is the presence of your law in your heart above the law of God. Where you're saying, I know God's law is there, but I think it's like this. What is the basis of you? I think, because I just feel it's like that, you know, where you put your law above the law of God. Suppose the law of God says, do not steal from God, or do not murder. I know all that is, the Bible says, the law of God says, the one who hates his brother is a murderer. Yeah, I know all that, but you know, Pastor, you don't know what he did to me. Yeah, you just don't know. That's lawlessness, where my law comes above the law, where I'm placing my righteousness, my law above the law of God and say, I know there is a law of God, but I don't want to obey that law of God because that person hurt me so much that I'm going to stand up and I'm going to stand in my own righteousness. So lawlessness is when you put your law above the law of God. The Bible declares the practicing of sin is lawlessness. It is a spiritual condition. When you look in 2 Thessalonians, it talks a few things about lawlessness. Number one, it says it is a spiritual condition. Lawlessness is a spiritual condition. It comes from your heart, from opening your life to demonic influences. Lawlessness is promoted by the devil. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verse 9. It says it is Satan who promotes lawlessness. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan with all power and false signs and wonders. Lawlessness because people don't love the truth. Why does lawlessness come in our heart? I want you to look at that verse. I want you to look at verse 10. Look at verse, if you're looking at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, we looked at 7, 8, 9. But I want you to look at verse 10 right now. How does lawlessness come? And with all, come on, read that together. With all the deception of wickedness for those who perish because what? They did not receive the love of the truth. Wait a minute. How does lawlessness come in my heart? When I don't want to receive that word of God. I'm saying, I know Bible is there. I know your preachers are all preaching all of that, but you don't know what I'm going through. You know what I'm saying? My condition is bigger than the possibility of God. My condition is so big that the Holy Spirit cannot help me. My condition is so strong that you don't understand. I understand what I'm going through. But the Bible says, when you do not love the truth, you are positioning yourself for deception. Lawlessness leads. That's the next verse. What happens when you don't love the truth? Look at verse 11. What happens? It leads you to deception. Let's look at that verse. Let's read it together. For this reason, God will what? Send upon them a deluding influence so that they will believe what is false. When people decide to live a life of lawlessness, what is lawlessness? My law above the law. When I keep my law above the law, the Bible says we are positioning ourselves to be deceived. The terrible thing about deception is when somebody is deceived, a deceived person does not know that he or she is deceived. Only someone who's not deceived is able to see that they are deceived. But a deceived one is walking in self-righteousness. You know, I've been through that. You don't know what I've gone through. So I'm constantly excusing myself. I'm constantly explaining away. I'm living in like this. I know you may call it lawlessness. I just call it weakness. You may call it sin. I just call it, you know, difficult time that I'm going through. But the fact is, I'm there because I am allowing myself to reject the truth and therefore I'm positioning myself to be deceived. Whenever we reject the truth, we are just positioning ourselves to be deceived. Shout at me, lawless one. This lawless one is a spiritual influence. How the demonic powers, the Bible says, according to 2 Thessalonians 2, the Bible says that the demonic powers want us to reject the truth. They want us to reject the word of God. They want us to reject and explain, you don't know what I've been through. You don't know what I'm going through. And the more we reject that, demonic powers know that you will get deceived. And he's trying his best to deceive you. Because once you are deceived, your heart will be hardened to truth. That you will not want to listen to any sense. You will be angry with God. You will be angry with the devil. You'll be angry with authority. You'll be angry with people all around you. And the fact is, you will think they are all responsible. When the truth is, deception has been responsible. Who deceived you? The Bible says Satan is the one behind it. He's the one who's deceiving you. So once this leads to deception, the Bible says they're all under condemnation. In fact, the Bible says that it is possible for us to be looking righteous on the outside or obedient to the law on the outside, but full of hypocrisy and lawlessness on the inside. Matthew's gospel in chapter 23 verse 28 says that. Where you can look righteous on the outside. You can be praying very righteous. You can be, You know, we've learned, you know, what monkey see, monkey do. We've been in church long enough. Father God, I want to praise you, Father, because you alone created the heavens and the earth. I mean, like he doesn't know he created the heavens and the earth. You got to remind him. You know, we get into this religious prayer and get into all kinds of things, thinking that that external expression of religion, we think we are obedient to God. No, we're not. Or because I know the Bible. See, some of y'all can think that because I know the Bible, therefore I am right. Because I know the Bible, I know better than them. That's self-righteousness. Therefore, I'm right. Guess what? You know who your companion is? Who knows the Bible in little more than you? The devil. Knowing the Bible doesn't make you righteous. Humility makes us humbling down at the foot of the cross and saying, Jesus, other than you, you are all my righteousness. I stand complete in you. And God is saying, I want you to be a slave of righteousness. Once you're a slave of righteousness, if you've died to your sin, then I want you to obey the word of God. That's what the Bible is declaring. But what does the Bible goes on to say? It says, in the last days, lawlessness will increase. These last days, Bible talks about the last days in Matthew 24. There are some signs of the last days, the Bible says. He says, if you look at some of the law, signs of the last days, he says, there'll be many signs. Matthew 24 verse 4, it says, be prepared for the last days. What does he say? Because many false Christs will arise. He's saying in the last days, people will come and they will claim that they are Christ or a cult like Christ. They will say, you know, you listen to me, my teaching is the right one, the others are wrong. And they will teach you things that are not of God. False Christs will arise. It goes on to say, Matthew 24:6 says, you will have many wars and rumors of wars. Just look around, people. In fact, when you study the First World War and Second World War, the truth of the matter, it was no world war. It really didn't include the world. When you look at the First World War and the Second World War, it was broadly first a European war. And then the European war being British, you know, influence in Japan got involved and America got involved and the Northern Hemisphere quite involved because Britain was involved, Australia was involved, the British Empire, the colony was involved. In such a way, many parts of the world got involved. But truly, it wasn't a world war. What did Fiji Islands have to do with that? What did Micronesian Islands have to do with that? And I was thinking in my heart, none of these islands were, these, they were not even involved in the world war. They had, I mean, the Austrian, you know, one man was killed, I think, when the First World War started, and that's how the whole thing started off. I mean, what do the Micronesian Islands have to do with somebody assassinated in Austria? It became a world global war. They called it the world war, but it wasn't. But when you look at today's time and age, when you look at, I was thinking the other day, how can the Bible says that, and the nations of the world will go to war against Israel. How can the whole nations of the world go to war? And it suddenly dawned on me, wait a minute. Right now, like never before, after the Second World War, there was formed the United Nations. And today when the United Nations passes a resolution, it's the nations of the world going against a nation. It is possible what was not possible in yesteryears. The Bible says, as Bible prophecy is being fulfilled one by one. You look at that. Today the wars are there. Rumors of wars. What happened in France just yesterday, day before yesterday night, was terrible and unacceptable thing in our time. You see, many people are saying peace, peace everywhere, and war is breaking out. One day the angels came and declared, glory to God in the highest and peace on earth. You can never have peace on earth. You can never have peace on earth unless you give glory to God in the highest. Amen. You cannot take that glory to God away and say we will have peace because He is the Prince of Peace. You can have pre-summit, peace summits. You can have Israel-Palestine, you know, peace summits. You can have nation-to-nation negotiation. But unless the Prince of Peace comes and becomes their King of Kings, you cannot have peace in that nation. You know, what people are trying to do are trying to bring an external change to internal. They think we change their outside circumstance, they will change in their heart. What Jesus is doing, I will change you on the inside and that will affect you on the outside. Once your inside becomes the peace of God, it affects every area of your life. Your family will have peace. Your city will have peace. Your churches will have peace because the gospel is changing you on the inside. Amen. It is a righteousness that takes you away from lawlessness and makes you want to follow the law of the living God. As you look at this, the Bible says many wars will be there. Then it says many famines and then many earthquakes. Earthquakes all around. You look at it. 2 weeks ago, was it, in Afghanistan, there was an earthquake that shook North India. couple of months ago, there was an earthquake that shook Kathmandu and the whole city was brought down a few months ago. You look at earthquakes happening all around, tsunamis and earthquakes. In fact, if you look at geological studies, you find out the earthquakes have increased like never before. These are coming to the last days. Signs. And the Bible says all these things are the beginning. The beginning of labor pains. If you ever carried a baby, you know from the fifth month onwards, there is something called false pain. It's called Braxton Hicks contractures. And the fifth month onwards, the uterus begins to contract a bit. You think you're going to have your baby. Hey, you got 4 months more to go. And then by the ninth month, when the pain really, you know, in the fifth month when it's contracting, you're thinking, oh, that's painful. You ain't seen nothing yet. Oh, my goodness. You know, when the labor pain comes on you, the Bible says these famines and wars and rumors of wars, they're all just the beginning. It's just the itno in the harambam, just the starting. It's just the little pain here and the little pain there. The Bible says there are signs of the last days. He said false Christ will come, wars will come, famines will come, earthquakes will come. Then he says many persecutions will come. In verse 9, he says many will be persecuted. They will put you to death. Then he says many betrayals will happen. Many will fall away and betray one another. I have often wondered, how can a brother betray a brother? How can the church of the living God? Bible is prophesying, days are coming, brothers will betray one another in the house of God. How can a Christian betray another? You know how they betray one another? Because of different philosophies. They will say, I think that brother, oh, he's preaching the gospel everywhere. He's too fundamentalistic. He's too radical. You don't need to preach the gospel. Just believe in your heart. Nothing else. What you believe, you know, just quietly. It's your personal faith. But the Bible says there's a great commission. No. This is your personal faith. Keep your Christ to yourself. You know, don't. And suddenly brothers begin to make Christian faith into different facets and say, I am the normal Christian. He is the radical one. He's too radical. And we begin to do that. You cannot see. I want to tell you something. If there's any faith you want to be radical about, it better be Christianity. Why? Because the greatest end of every Christianity, love God and love people. Radically love God and radically love people. It'll hurt nobody. Amen. 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 And it's not a religion. It's a relationship with God. Radically love God and radically love people. And you will be the healing virtue in the land. Persecutions, betrayals. But then he talks about 2-3 more signs. He says one more sign is going to die. He says false preachers will come. One of the signs of the last days is that many false preachers will come. And they will preach all kinds of lies to you. The Bible says, in 1 Peter it says, he who speaks, let him speak like he's speaking the very words God spoke on his heart to speak. That when he speaks, he's sure this is what God has asked him to speak. Wow. If anybody speaks like that, how can we make merchandise of the gospel? Some people have started making merchandise of the gospel because they know that's what you like to hear. Oh, it'll make you feel nice. They'll make you feel, you just smile a little more. Be a little more kind, a little more. The whole world is waiting for you to smile. They make merchandise of the gospel. And the Bible says lawlessness will increase because you're preaching what they want to hear. What is the truth of God's church? Is it numbers? Or is it people that are carrying this glory of God? Is it people that are carrying the love of God? Am I saying we've got to be rigid, very hard people? No, go out and love people. But speak the truth in love. The problem is that legalists speak the truth with pride. The ones who are following legalism, I'm obeying all these laws, therefore, you know, I must be good. So the legalists, they speak the truth in pride. The lawless ones, they speak lies. They don't speak the truth, or they speak half-truth. They speak the truth that they want to speak and they keep quiet about the others. But the ones who are liberated in the Spirit of God, walking under the Holy Ghost, they speak the truth in love, in agape, in unconditional love. They're not afraid to declare the truth. And that is why, I'm telling you, when you listen to the message of Jesus, he confronted lawlessness. When you look at the message of Paul, he confronted lawlessness. When you look at, he did not, his message was not, Everybody come to church. Jesus loves you. It's all good. He stood before King Agrippa and said, King Agrippa, I want you to know that, you know, I want you to become everything except these chains. I want you to, you know, the Bible says that he spoke to him concerning righteousness. And he spoke to King Agrippa concerning, you ready for this? This was his gospel preaching. He spoke to King Agrippa and Festus concerning the coming judgment of God. Whoa. You mean in his one time message, he had one go at it. He had one time to go. And he stood there and said, Agrippa and Festus, King Agrippa, I know you're the king. Festus, I know you're the governor. I know you guys are too cool in the land. You guys are big names. I know I'm in chains. I know I may not have another chance. I have one chance to tell you. And here's my message. There is a coming judgment. And you get ready for this coming judgment. He spoke the truth. Then he said, and Festus said, do you want to be me to be like you? He said, I want you to be everything except these chains. I want you to be everything except these chains. And he goes on to say that many false preachers will come in the last days. And these false preachers will tell you what you want to hear. Then the Bible says, verse 12, it says, and there because lawlessness is increased, most people's love will grow cold. You ever wondered why love grows cold? Your answer is there. Because when you put your law above the law of God, your love grows cold. Your love grows cold when you put your law above the law of God. Because lawlessness is increased. Their love grows cold. So what happens in this setting? It says many will be betraying, many will be hurting one another. But the Bible says the gospel will be preached. In this setting, when the Bible talks about this whole concept of lawlessness and this whole concept of lawlessness, what is the answer to lawlessness? The answer to lawlessness is the grace of God. When you begin to walk under this mighty grace of God, C.S. Lewis said once, he said, the grace of God is such an awesome thing that you can spend your whole lifetime talking about it and still not run out. You can still talk about the grace of God. But the problem is, in today's time and age, people are talking about the mercy of God and they're calling it grace. What is the difference between mercy and grace? Mercy is the cancellation of the penalty of sin. That is mercy. It is the cancellation of the penalty of sin. But what is grace? Grace is God's power on you to win over sin. To walk a life of victory. Hallelujah. So when grace comes on your life, it is a divine enablement on you to live a life of victory. Hallelujah. His grace is available to live a life of victory. His grace is available to walk in this life of victory. There is a divine enablement on your life and my life. But in the midst of this grace period, this grace is so powerful. It is the righteousness of God in me. This grace is so powerful. I'm so excited about this amazing grace of God. That this grace is the answer for you and me to walk in victory. If this grace is the answer for you and me to walk in victory, then be assured the devil will make a counterfeit. Listen to me. If this grace is the answer, then be assured that the devil will make a counterfeit. Because he wants to deceive you. He wants to cheat you from your victory. He wants to make you live a defeated life. He wants to lie to you about that you can never walk in victory. Because this grace of God is available, what did people do? The Bible says in the last days, preachers will come. And they will tell you what you want to hear. They will tell you what your ears are itching to hear. So this whole group of people came together and they're called the hyper grace movement. What is this hyper grace movement? Hyper grace movement is so broad that it's hard to classify. I would say any teaching taught about the grace of God, which is beyond the grace available for a life of victory, is hyper grace. I recently sat down and I started putting down some of the teachings of these hyper grace movement people. And there are different names. I could tell you many different names, but I don't want to malign names on record. here, but I want to tell you, as you go back, you listen to these teachings, you will know these are people that are teaching false doctrine. What is the problem with hypergrace preachers? The problem is that many of them are not teaching lies, but they're not teaching the whole truth. They're teaching only part of the truth. While there are other hypergrace preachers who do not acknowledge these small hypergrace preachers, who are small aberrations. The real serious hypergrace preachers, they are teaching lies. They are going the whole way and denying everything that the Bible talks about. What does this Bible talk about? The Bible talks about in the last days, false preachers will come. False preachers that will come and teach all kinds of lies. I have just put down some thoughts of mine that I listened to some of these hypergrace preachers and what they are rejecting today. Listen to me carefully. When you know the truth, this truth shall set you free. Amen. And some of these people are so famous that if you saw them, you wouldn't recognize them. But if you listen to what they're saying, you will understand they're teaching only half the truth. And teaching half the truth, why? Because that's what people want to hear. Because that'll make people feel good. Another reason why they teach this, why they teach hypergrace, is because many of these preachers have been hurt by legalists who told them you're not good enough. You told them, no, you're messed up. You told them you'll never come up. When they heard about the grace of God, they felt such a liberation. They wanted to tell the whole world about the liberty in the grace of God. Now, the problem is that there's no harm in telling the whole world that God's power is available to set you free. But when in this liberty, they forgot to tell you not to walk in lawlessness, that becomes a problem. Because the grace preachers do not want, why won't these hyper grace preachers tell you not to walk in sin? They're afraid to tell you that. Why would they be afraid to tell you that? They will sound like the legalists. So they don't want a branding. They don't want others to think, oh, he's a legalist. So they don't want that branding. So they will tell you about grace. They will tell you about the power of God's grace. But they will not tell you about walking away from sin. What are some of the signs you can see of a hypergrace preaching? I'm going to just give you some signs. And maybe I will continue it into the next week. But listen to some of the signs. One of the first thing you will see about hypergrace preachers. What are hypergrace preachers? I'm not talking about grace. Grace is divine enablement by the Holy Spirit. It is God's empowerment to walk in victory over sin. Hypergrace is half truth or no truth at all. What does hypergrace do? Hypergrace preachers, they talk about, now I'll tell you why I'm talking about hypergrace. Because when you understand hypergrace, people misunderstand the foundations of grace and think that it's okay to live in lawlessness. What is hypergrace? Hypergrace preaching says that I am the righteousness of God in Christ. Right or wrong? It's right. But what they stick by is that they stick to only preaching positional righteousness. By faith, I am righteous. They stick to that and they teach nothing else. Because if they teach a righteousness of walking in obedience to God, they will sound like the legalists. They're afraid of spoiling their brand image. Because their brand image has a lot to do with merchandising the gospel. It's all about brand building. Because if they get any other name by what they preach, they will be called lawless. I've had this difficult predicament. I deal with both legalists and lawless people. The legalists call me a grace preacher. And the hyper grace guys, they call me a law preacher. I'm at least glad both are against me. That means I'm somewhere in between. I'm in the grace of God. Amen. You can't walk in legalism and make that your righteousness. You can't make your good works your righteousness. It just does not hold before God. You can't make lawlessness your lifestyle. That doesn't hold before God. What are some of the signs of hypergrace? The first sign I want to tell you about hypergrace preaching that leads to lawlessness is that they do not want to present the word of God in its whole truth, sounding like commandments. They don't want to make the word of God sound like commandments. You know what that is like? It's like looking at a two-year-old kid and saying, Mune, I know you don't feel like having dinner tonight. It's okay. No problem. Yesterday you had? No, very good. Day first, no problem. Very good. Next week you'll have? Okay. Today you don't want? Okay. Tomorrow? No, don't want. Day after tomorrow also you don't want? No problem. You had, when you were born, you had milk? Yeah, that's enough. That's it's keeping you happy by one truth, but not allowing you to walk in victory by presenting the laws of Scripture of the New Testament. There are New Testament laws in the Bible, but they're afraid to allow anything sound like law. They're just afraid of their grace preaching being damaged. Grace will be damaged by teaching half-truth. Then how do I preach the grace of God? By preaching about a life in the Spirit of God. There are laws in the New Testament where the Bible talks about a law of the Spirit. Bible talks about the law of faith. Bible talks about the law of being a new creation. Bible talks about the law of Christ. The Bible talks about the law of liberty. The Bible talks about so many different laws in the New Testament. And these are Spirit-filled, Spirit-led laws. But the grace preachers don't want to sound like the legalists. Therefore, they will tell you, it's okay, just follow the grace of God. One of the first signs of a grace preaching, they will not preach the whole counsel of God. They will preach one aspect. They reject the importance of the commandments simply to promote the teaching on grace. They want to preach part gospel. They want to preach part gospel. Turn with me to 2 Peter. I want to quickly look at 2 Peter in chapter 2. I want to just show you a couple of thoughts from this. 2 Peter. Look, you know, when you see what this is, it'll blow your mind. 2 Peter in chapter 2. It talks about these people that are making merchandise of the gospel. The Bible calls them false prophets. Say it loud, false prophets. Say false teachers. So Bible calls them false teachers and false prophets. Now let me just read that for you. But false prophets are believers or unbelievers? Come on, 2 Peter, they're writing to whom? Whom is he writing to? Believers or unbelievers? Come on, I can't hear you. Believers. To believers. So where are these false prophets he's talking about? In the church or outside the church? In the church. What are these false prophets doing? Keeping quiet or teaching in the crowd? They're teaching. So what is he talking about? He's talking about some preachers and some teachers inside the believing community. Now, having got that record straight, listen to this. But false prophets also arose among the people. Which people is he talking about? The believers. Just as there will also be false teachers among you. Believers or unbelievers? Believers. Who will secretly, how will they, secretly what? Introduce what? Destructive what? Heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing swift destruction upon themselves. What are these false preachers doing? They are secretly introducing heresies. What does that mean? It'll sound nice, but it won't be the truth. They'll be secretly introducing wrong teaching. Secretly introducing. Look at the rest. And look at verse 2. Come on, somebody read it. Help me. What? What does it say? What? How many will follow? Many. Which means that teaching will be popular. That teaching will be acceptable. The teaching will be mass media. Their preaching will be, happy for everybody to hear. It says over here, and many will follow their sensuality. And because of them, the way of truth will be, which means they will live in sin. They will disobey God. One man of God, recently I was talking to someone. He said, one man of God told this other senior man of God, oh, committing adultery is like blowing my nose, man. Just blow it and throw it away. Continue with life inside the house of God. The Bible says these people are preaching sensuality and many of them are following their ways because they're hearing these preachers preaching from the pulpit. Oh, the grace of God alone. No problem. Live how you want, brother. God's grace is there. Goes on. And in their what? Come on. In their what? In their what? Wait a minute. Where are they? Greedy? Where are they expressing their greed? What are they? preachers and prophets. Where? In the house of God. So where are they expressing their greed? Which means these false preachers are making merchandise of the gospel. In their greed, they will, you know what? Take your plastic cards out, swipe it, brother, right now. Oh, God is going to just bless you. And there's this prophet. You put it onto this soil right now, $100 bill, and the blessing of God's coming upon you right now. Receive it. They exploit you. They exploit you. What? You know what that means? They exploit you with false teaching that will keep you happy. They will lie to you. It's like feeding your little two-year-old with chocolate syrup in the morning, chocolate syrup in the evening, and a bar of chocolate in the night. Any kid will refuse that? No, they won't. Oh, and if the kid has a card, he'll swipe it for you. If you will let him eat what he wants. But how terrible you parents are. You shove that veggie down his throat and say, it is good for you. And he kicks and he screams and hopes that never happens again. But it is that which grew them. What has brought us thus far? Truth has set us free. Amen. They will exploit you with their false teaching, with their words. Their judgment from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep. False teachers, the Bible is saying, their judgment is not idle, destruction is not asleep. For if God did not spare angels when they sinned, but cast them into hell and committed them in the pits of darkness, reserved for judgment, and did not spare the ancient world, but preserved Noah, a preacher of righteousness, with seven others when he brought a flood upon the world of the ungodly. Who is he writing this to? The Jews or Gentiles? First Peter, whom is he writing to? He's writing to the Gentiles. And if he commended the cities of Sodom, Gomorrah to destruction by reducing them to ashes, having made them an example to those who would live ungodly thereafter, and if he rescued righteous Lot, oppressed by sensual conduct of unprincipled men, for by what he saw and heard the righteous man while living among them, felt his righteous soul tormented day after day with their lawless deeds, then the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from temptation and keep the unrighteous under punishment for the day of judgment, especially those who indulge in the flesh. This is talking about the unrighteous for the day of judgment, especially those who indulge in its flesh, in corrupt desires, despise authority, daring, self-willed. They do not tremble when they revile angelic majesties, whereas angels who are greater in might and power do not bring a reviling judgment against them before the Lord. But these, like unreasonable animals, born as creatures of instinct to be captured and killed, reviling while they have no knowledge, will in the destruction of those creatures also be destroyed. Which means when the demonic angels are going to be sent to hell, these rebellious false prophets and false teachers are going to be destroyed along with the destruction of angels. Suffering wrong as the wages of doing wrong, they count it pleasure to revile in daytime. They are stains and blemishes, reviling in their deception as they carouse with you. Carouse with you? The church of God? Having eyes full of adultery that never cease from sin, enticing unstable souls, having a heart trained in greed, accursed children, forsaking the right way, which means they know the right way, but they have gone astray, having followed the way of Balaam, which is the desire to make money, son of who loved the wages of unrighteousness, but he received a rebuke for his own transgression from a dumb donkey, speaking with the voice of man, restrained madness of the prophet. These are springs without water and mists driven by a storm, for whom the black darkness has been reserved. Hell has been reserved for them, the Bible says. For the false preachers. For speaking out arrogant words of vanity, they entice fleshly desires by sensuality, those who barely escape from the ones who live in error. Promising them freedom. Promising them freedom, while they themselves are slaves of corruption. This is the challenge. Promising them freedom, themselves are slaves of corruption. The last state has become worse for them than the first. Believers or unbelievers? Where is their place in the coming days? In the church, what is their judgment? Is this in your Bible also? Or does it only say once you're the grace of God, you're saved, you're all on your way to heaven? The Bible talks about false preachers, neither walking in freedom nor are loving others, because they're making merchandise with their false words. And then the Bible says, reserved blackness is for them. For if after they have escaped the defilement of the world, believer or unbeliever, come on, somebody help me. Believer or unbeliever, after they have escaped the defilement of the world by the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and they are again entangled in them and are overcome, the last state has become worse for them than the first. Believer or unbeliever? For it would be better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than to know it, to turn away the holy commandment delivered to them. Holy commandment delivered to them. Believer or unbeliever? Does the New Testament have commandments? Come on, somebody help me. Is there a law of God in the New Testament? Yes, there is. Who is it handed over to? To the New Testament saints. The Bible is saying they're making merchandise out of it by preaching enticing partial truths. Oh, brother, no problem. Live how you want. Okay. But some may tell me, have you ever heard them preach live how you want? No, they'll never say that. You know what they'll say? It doesn't matter how you live. You are the righteousness of God. They'll never say live how you want. You'll still be righteous. They will say it doesn't matter how you live. You are still the positional righteousness of God. Enticing words. Does that minimize God's grace? No. Does that mean His grace is not powerful? No. But that does mean there are people out there who are going to lie to you about this, and they want to leave you in a life of lawlessness. It happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to its vomit and a sow after washing returns to wallow in its mire. The first sign of a hypergrace preacher is that they will reject the whole counsel of God's word. People of God, I want to encourage you. Come back to the word of God. Come back to the truth of God's word. The word anointed by the Holy Ghost. You will live a life of victory. No work of the enemy can stop you. No false doctrine can stop you in your tracks. You will arise in your generation. Neither will you walk around judging everybody, because you know you are just the result of the amazing mercy of God. Nor will you walk around in lawlessness, because you know the grace of God is available. You will neither be in that end, nor you will be in this end. You will be walking in the mighty grace of God. Amen. Thank you.